Well, some of the symptoms I had before I was diagnosed, I didn't really think about it at the time. At certain times, part of my body would go numb and I would kind of get blurry vision and my speech would be slurred. Right when I got pregnant with my son, I started shaking, a little bit of the shaking and tremors, but I kind of didn't think nothing of that either, but it got more and more so after I had my son. Then I went to the neurologist to start seeing what it was.
Charity is a patient of mine who I follow with Parkinson's disease. I initially saw her when she had had symptoms for some period of time. She's quite young, so I think because of her age, she'd been seen by other physicians and even neurologists, and Parkinson's disease really hadn't been thought about.
When I found out, I really didn't know anything other than the Michael J. Fox had it, and that was pretty much it. I've thought about if it was hereditary, and I've heard that it is, and it can be hereditary, it may not be. So I've thought about, what if my kids get it, but there's really no way to really tell if they're going to or not, because I'm the only one in my family who has it.
For younger onset patients, so under the age of 45, the chances that their Parkinson's has a larger genetic component, whether it's a single gene disorder or just a genetic susceptibility, is quite a lot greater. So for under 45s, the genetic component as opposed to the environmental component of the disease is quite a bit bigger.
First degree relatives, which are children, parents, siblings, are at about twice the risk to develop Parkinson's disease as the general population. But what this means is by 65, everyone has about a 1% risk of developing Parkinson's disease, so it increases their risk to about 2%.
You may have a particular genetic makeup that might put you at risk for a given disease, but without some environmental influence or some other genetic influence, you may never show signs of the disease.
So it's a very complicated interplay of genetics and environment, we think, and not just a single gene probably causing the disease in the vast majority of cases, but a number of different genes and then the environment that someone's exposed to. There are rare cases where there's an autosomal recessive form, which means both parents would have to have a copy of the gene for the child to get it, or occasional autosomal dominant forms, but these represent an extremely small portion of those affected by Parkinson's disease.
Genetics is complicated, and it's not always as simple as having a gene means you will get the disease. There are a number of commercial enterprises out there. It can give you some broad information about your risks for specific diseases, but whether those risks actually predict that you will develop those diseases or not is really very limited. The tests really don't have any clinical utility. One concern that is often asked about is the risks to insurability. There are some protections in place, both at the level of the state and also federal. There's a relatively new federal law called GINA, which is the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, that provides some protections for health insurance in the face of genetic information disclosure. There is a general consensus that we will not test minors for an adult onset disease, particularly one where there is no disease modifying treatment. So we can't give the person something that will delay or prevent onset. For the vast majority of people who have Parkinson's disease, genetic testing really doesn't have a role. And for a very few people where it might be considered, it should always be undertaken in a carefully considered way with the appropriate providers involved, including their neurologist, perhaps a medical geneticist, and a genetics counselor.
One thing of importance is that the person wanting the genetic testing is the one who has to go for the counseling. So it may be that a parent has Parkinson's disease and is worried about the risk to their child. That child has to make the decision to go to genetic counseling.
Excellent. Now let your arms come down and open your eyes.
When my daughter's 18 or my son's 18 at that time, if that's what they choose, then I'll leave it up to them. If they know there's not really anything they can do, then if they want to know, then fine. If not, then just let it be.
And generally in those people, we see it within a family where multiple members have it.
We don't have the ability to test for all the genes that may be involved. So just because someone's testing comes back negative for what we have available, doesn't mean that they're not going to develop Parkinson's disease. So I think that really has to be strongly understood with a disease like Parkinson's, that we may be able to check for these very common mutations, but within the whole population, those represent a really small portion of the people who are going to get Parkinson's disease.
Many of the genes that have been found, the most valuable thing about them is that they have helped us to understand the biology of Parkinson's disease.
So it's really at this point gaining information for the broader population as a whole, rather than likely to benefit any individual patient.
There is a lot of ongoing research into the genetics of Parkinson's disease. There are many research projects that are going on, both within the Veterans Administration and outside. And so if people want to know about what research projects might be involved at their particular institution, they can check in with their PADREC or their VA provider, who usually has a listing of those types of studies.
So to summarize on Parkinson's and genetics, it's a very complicated issue at this point. And we're really at the point of doing research in this area, and it's not something that's clinically appropriate to be testing people.
Jodie hasn't said anything about passing it on to her kids. I don't know if she's really thought about it or if she just tries not to think about that type of aspect of it because she doesn't want to have to worry about what's going to happen in the future. I think she's just more focused on living the best life she can now and not worrying about what's going to do in the future.
The best advice I could give for people who are diagnosed is, yeah, it's kind of shocking at first, and you might sit there and be like, well, why me? But, you know, you can't stop living. Thank you.